गुड आफ्टरनून फ्रेंड्स, इन कंटिन्यूएशन ऑफ माय लेक्चर सेशंस ऑन बायोकेमिस्ट्री फॉर फार्मेसी स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे इन दिस सेशन वी विल डिस्कस इन डिटेल अबाउट प्रोटीन्स एंड अमीनो एसिड्स, देयर डाइजेशन एंड एब्जॉर्प्शन. ओके, सो इन द लास्ट क्लास वी हैव सीन इन डिटेल अबाउट प्रोटीन्स एंड स्पेसिफिक फीचर्स ऑफ प्रोटीन्स लाइक protein 3D structure and ability of a protein to move so that it can achieve physical movement, it can bring about physical movement in living organisms. So all the specific chemistry and its role in these special capabilities of protein are discussed at length. Okay, so in this session we will discuss about digestion and absorption. So let's discuss about protein, foods that are enriched with proteins, and specific requirements for a protein rich food to be considered as a very good resource for amino acids. So these are some of the examples of protein containing foods like cheese, curd, cottage cheese, meat, eggs, etc. Please don't worry about the quantities, because this is the percentage in case of wet, in the wet condition. Okay, let's say if you take meat, we presume that meat completely is protein, but at least 80% of it is actually water. So that's the reason why 13% of the egg only will contain protein by weight. So these are all some of the very useful and popular proteinous foods that are available for our consumption, and every person need to consume at least 0.4 grams per kg of proteins, and optimally we need to consume at least 0.8 grams per kg of the body weight. Let's say if I am 100 kg, I should be consuming 80 grams of protein every day. Okay, the biological value of a protein rich food is the mass of the body proteins synthesized from 100 grams of protein. Okay, let's say if you are consuming food material, proteinous food, let's say if you are consuming 100 grams of the protein, how much of that is actually absorbed and integrated into your body is very important for us. Okay, surprisingly, you will see the biological value depends on the availability of essential amino acids. Okay, these are the essential amino acids, because regarding amino acids we had discussed in the last class. Okay, so among them, these are all the essential amino acids, like we have valine, leucine, isoleucine, threonine, lysine, methionine, phenylalanine, tryptophan, histidine and arginine. Okay, so these two are essential for children. For elders, arginine and histidine can be synthesized from other amino acids. Okay, so if you see different kinds of foods, like here, biological value for different foods, when you compare, eggs actually have proteins which can be absorbed and assimilated into, integrated into proteins up to 97%. Okay, so, and then next come milk, and then come the remaining. Okay, so here in the vegetable sources, oat flakes top the list, and wheat germ. Okay, so that contains 53% of proteins can be absorbed, whereas eggs and milk. They contain complete spectrum of amino acids that are necessary for our body building. So this is one reason why those people who are working on body sculpturing, okay, like body building, etc., they are asked to, for fitness, they are asked to consume egg whites. Egg white means egg albumin. Okay, so this is about the food. Now, how actually food is digested? Because in case of proteins, as we have seen in the last class, one amino acid is connected to another amino acid via amide bond. Okay, via amide bond. So such amino acids, so many will be there. And these much bigger molecules cannot be absorbed. Hence, what will happen? Cannot be absorbed. Hence, it has to be cut down into smaller pieces so that at least either amino acid or a dipeptide or a tripeptide, up to this we can absorb, not beyond this one. So that's the reason we have to convert this polypeptide, a very huge protein molecule, into smaller fragments. Okay, we have enzymes for all these processes. Digestion is the process of treating a substance with heat, enzymes or solvent to promote decomposition or extract essential components. Okay, this is the actual definition of digestion. So here a protein is taken up into our gastrointestinal tract, and by using heat, enzymes and acidic environment, the protein is decomposed and are digested and broken down into smaller pieces, and essential components are absorbed into our system. So this is our digestive tract. First let's see what happens in the mouth. So in the mouth, the only thing that happens is chewing, so that it can mechanically degrade the food material into smaller pieces. It also helps mix the food with saliva so that you can swallow it easily. In mouth, we have only two types of enzymes are there. One is salivary amylase, and a little bit of salivary lipase will also be there. But regarding proteins, we don't have any enzymes. You will not see any kind of enzymes in the saliva. Then, stomach. Stomach plays a major role in the digestion of amino acid, proteins and amino acids, because stomach contains specific modified cells, and they, in their arrangements, we call them as secretory cells. So these are parietal cells. The secretory cells are what we call them as parietal cells. So parietal cells release hydrochloric acid into the stomach lumen, okay, into stomach. So pH is very important. Acidic pH is essential for hydrolysis of amide bond. So protein degradation begins in the stomach, where the acidic environment favors protein denaturation. Okay, a protein remains functional, a protein maintains its integrity only when it is able to maintain the three-dimensional shape. Because of extreme acidic condition in the stomach, protein gets denatured, so thereby its structural integrity is compromised. Further, protein undergoes primary proteolysis as catalyzed by gastric pepsin, which works optimally at pH number 2. Okay, so at this pH, gastric pepsin can digest proteins, break them to smaller peptides. Then the food material is sent into the small intestine. In between, you will find digestive juices that are released into the intestinal lumen via duodenum. See, here we have two things. One is liver and gallbladder, because liver synthesizes bile, etc., and it stores in gallbladder, and pancreas releases some more enzymes. But especially in case of proteins, proteases are very powerful hydrolyzing enzymes. So in our system, proteins are ubiquitous. They are everywhere. So many enzymes, cell membranes and other fibers, etc., are everywhere, and they does essential works for our survival. So that's the reason why if a protease is released into the system in its active form, then that there is a possibility that those enzymes can attack our own proteins, so thereby it will affect the function of a cell. So that's the reason why proteases are always synthesized as inactive form. Proteases are synthesized and released in its inactive form, so that they gets activated at optimal pH or in the presence of an activating enzyme. Okay, so that is the arrangement which helps us maintain our structural integrity. Otherwise, what would happen? So had we got the enzyme in its active format, released into the stomach directly, then it would have digested the stomach lumen itself. Okay, so that's the reason why it has to be synthesized in its inactive format, and then as and when it is needed by using appropriate pH and enzyme, it gets activated and it does the job, and then it will be eliminated from our system in a particular manner. Okay, that we'll see. So degradation continues in the lumen. Whatever started in the stomach, it continues in the lumen of the intestine, owing to the activity of a pancreatic proteolytic enzyme. Okay, so as I told you in the last classes, in carbohydrates as well as lipases, pancreas synthesizes and releases enzymes for the digestion. In case of carbohydrates, we have amylase. In case of lipids, we have lipase, and here we have proteases. But here they are secreted as inactive proteolytic enzymes. Okay, inactive proenzymes, and converted into the active enzymes within the intestinal lumen. And then the digestion is then completed by aminopeptidases located in the plasma membrane, brush border of the enterocytes. So these intestinal lumen, maximum digestion will be over, and the proteins will be degraded into smaller peptides, and then they will go up to tripeptides. So these tripeptides, three amino acid containing units, will reach the brush border of the small intestine, where in the villi, microvilli, we call them as microvilli, and from there it in the luminal region you will find enteropeptidases, aminopeptidases. They degrade their tripeptides into monopeptides, so that dipeptides and monopeptides, so that they will be absorbed. Single amino acids as well as di and tripeptides are transported across the membrane into the cells by using an active transporter system that we will see in the coming slides, and then they will be amino acids will be released into the blood. Okay, so these are the some of the enzymes. In stomach we have the proenzyme is pepsinogen will be converted to pepsin in the presence of acid. Okay, in pancreas, from pancreas, chymotrypsinogen, procarboxypeptidase, proelastase, so these are the enzymes that are released. They will be activated into chymotrypsin, trypsin, carboxypeptidase and elastase. Okay, how these changes happens and what are the various factors which controls it, let's see. So enteropeptidases secreted by mucosa of duodenum initiates the activation of the pancreatic proenzymes by first activating trypsin. Okay, so enteropeptidases that are present on the mucosa of the duodenum inside. Okay, so that initiates, that converts protrypsin to trypsin, trypsinogen to trypsin, trypsinogen to trypsin, which then activates the other proenzymes. So enteropeptidase, trypsinogen to trypsin, the trypsin will activate proelastase to elastase, chymotrypsinogen to chymotrypsin, prolipase to lipase, procarboxypeptidase to carboxypeptidase. So this is the it is actually the trypsin which is important. So release of trypsin into the system or activation of trypsin decides the extent to which digestion has to happen. Okay, so trypsin is activating all these proenzymes to active enzymes. Okay, proteolytic enzymes of the GIT and what actually they does. Proteinases or endopeptidases preferentially attacks the bond for pepsin, trypsin, chymotrypsin and elastase. These are all called as endopeptidases or proteinases. So pepsin preferentially attacks the amide bond that is coming after an aromatic amino acid like phenylalanine and tyrosine, and acidic amino acids like glutamic acid and aspartic acid. That means, let's say if the amino acid sequence is going on in this direction, let's say one amino acid is there, second amino acid is there, third amino acid is there, it goes on like this. So let's say here we have phenylalanine, then we have CONH, and then we have here some glycine is there. Then this bond will be broken down by the pepsin enzyme. Okay, so this is what I mean by. Then trypsin preferentially attacks basic amino acids like arginine and lysine. Chymotrypsin attacks hydrophobic amino acids like phenylalanine, tyrosine, tryptophan, leucine, and acidic amino acids like glutamic acid and aspartic acid. Elastase can approach small side chain containing amino acids which are not heavily substituted, like glycine, alanine, lysine. These amino acids are preferred by elastase. Peptidases or exopeptidases preferentially attacks the bond after exopeptidases, carboxypeptidase A, carboxypeptidase B, leucine aminopeptidase, dipeptidase. So these are the enzymes that we have. In carboxypeptidase, it covers almost all amino acids but except arginine and lysine. Carboxypeptidase B, basic amino acids like arginine and lysine. In leucine aminopeptidase, and nearly breaks down all kinds of, because it doesn't have any preference. Dipeptidase only breaks down dipeptide bonds. Okay, dipeptide means what? Two amino acids joined together. Okay, so this is the way how proteolytic enzymes, they have preferential sites for. Proteolytic enzymes have preferential sites for their action. So while digesting, it is not just digesting a particular protein, but even in the hydrolysis of a protein, appropriate proteases can degrade protein in a specific manner. Okay, so this is of very much importance in understanding protein chemistry. As I told you, the proteins are hydrolyzed into amino acids and smaller peptides. We call smaller peptides as oligopeptides, like which contain 78 amino acids, and they will be recognized by aminopeptidases that are attached membrane bound to the gut cells. So thereby they are hydrolyzed to amino acids and tripeptides. Okay, so these two are absorbed across the membrane via symport mechanism, that is sodium symport mechanism. Okay, so here the amino acids or tripeptides that are released, that are there in the cell, are released into the blood via the similar mechanism. Okay, so this is an ATPase enzyme will be there, where ATP is consumed to ADP. So sodium ATPase, ATPase system actually helps in the transport of amino acids across a membrane, so that's why it is an active transport mechanism, So absorption of amino acids and peptides is an active process obligatorily coupled to uptake of sodium. It is driven by the large difference of sodium concentration across the brush border membrane, that is maintained by sodium potassium ATPase. So there are at least 7 different sodium linked amino acid transporters are there in our system. Okay, so friends, this is the way how amino acids that are released into the gut will be absorbed. So proteins that are consumed are hydrolyzed to amino acids or oligopeptides. Okay, so these oligopeptides are also hydrolyzed to either amino acids or di or tripeptides, and these will be absorbed into the cell via sodium potassium ATPase active transport mechanism. Okay, so in case of carbohydrates, we have something like a storage mechanism. But here, in case of amino acids, we don't have anything like the storage mechanism is not there. So that's the reason why, especially when you are consuming food, lipids 100% absorbed, carbs 100% absorbed. What about proteins? So proteins are not digested 100%, and mostly you can see it being excreted undigested. In case of carbohydrates also, you can see like fibrous material only can be excreted. But here in protein, the food material itself, when it cannot be digested, it will be excreted. So protein absorption, okay, amino acid absorption is a controlled process. So that's the reason why whatever you consume cannot go into your body. Okay, whatever you are eating cannot be integrated into your body, especially in case of proteins. So that's the reason why protein absorption is tightly controlled and maintained properly. What do I mean by this? Let's say if I am simply eating and sleeping, I don't need to use skeletal muscles. So hence, I don't need to do any anabolic tasks. Okay, but if you are eating but working, going to a gym, then skeletal muscle activity will be very high, then anabolic activity will be very high. So this stimulates increased absorption and assimilation of amino acids, assimilation of amino acids. So this is the way how. But in case of carbohydrates and lipids, this type of regulatory mechanisms will not be there. Only for amino acids, it will be there. The uniqueness of proteins is, in our body, proteins are almost all the time recycled. Okay, recycled. Because whatever is there inside your body, what can happen if a cell is there? If it is alive, because it contains so many things, enzymes, and say cytoskeleton and signaling molecules. So in these so many other ways, you will find protein presence in cell. Let's say if a cell goes to lysis, then what will happen? All these proteins will become metabolized by amino acids into amino peptidases into amino acids. These amino acids will again will be reused for biosynthesis of the enzymes or cytoskeleton or cell signaling molecules for newer cells, for new cells. But a little bit of amino acid pool will be diverted to energy production, okay, or else synthesizing special molecules like signaling molecules, okay, insulin, or else certain peptide derived amino acid derived molecules like creatine, okay, or signaling molecules like oxytocin, or inflammatory mediators like interleukins. So these are all biosynthesized. So that's the reason why amino acid pool will lose a little bit of amino acids because of these activities. So energy, if you are using it for energy, it is completely destroyed. Okay, so all these amino acids that are utilized for all this is to be replenished. Okay, replenished via diet. Okay, so that's the reason why amino acid pool is to be maintained. For maintenance, we need to add a little bit of protein daily, so that the internal protein chemistry can be maintained. Now let's see. Let's say you have taken dietary proteins. Approximately 80 grams is needed. In intestine, in the gastrointestinal tract, as much as 70 grams of proteins are secreted. Okay, secretion 70 grams per day. So in this 70 grams per day, and in the intestine, we can absorb 140 grams of protein per day. Array, here we are taking only 80 grams, but here absorption is 140 grams. How it is possible? Can you use your logic? Because above intestine we have mouth. Okay, so salivary amylase is also a protein. Lipase is also a protein. So whatever is secreted into saliva will go into intestine, where those proteins will also add to this one, that one, and this one. Both together, they are coming up to 140 grams. So all of them are absorbed and they will join to amino acid pool. So in the amino acid pool, you will have amino acids, dipeptides, tripeptides, etc. But free amino acids that are always available in plasma are approximately 70 grams. Okay, and then from this proteosynthesis, because per day in our body as much as 260 grams to 400 grams of proteins are synthesized. Okay, from the available resources, these proteins includes enzymes, signaling molecules, then protecting molecules like clotting, fibrinogen, fibrin, etc., and the cytoskeleton. Okay, and also repair proteins, because let's say if you are working, muscle sprain is there, that has to be repaired. All of them are done by proteins only. So that's the reason why 260 to 400 grams of protein is biosynthesized daily. So here plasma proteins, visceral proteins, and muscle proteins are some of the examples of the synthesized proteins. Plasma proteins contains so many albumin, globular proteins at approximately 20 grams of plasma proteins are synthesized. Visceral proteins 50 grams are synthesized. Muscle proteins 50 grams are synthesized. And these are all also a part of amino acid pool. They get degraded and then they eventually are added to amino acid pool. From amino acid pool, specific products are synthesized. As I told you, signaling molecules are synthesized. And then amino acid pool gets depleted because of its degradation for energy production or gluconeogenesis, where ammonia is released. Ammonia and carbon dioxide together, they will give you urea. Approximately 70 grams of protein equivalent of urea is excreted per day. Okay, for a normal healthy human being with 70 kg weight, male approximately excretes urea that is equivalent to 70 grams of protein. This is the observation which led to the conclusion that a healthy male, 70 kg male, has to consume approximately 1 gram per kg of protein. 1 gram per kg of protein. Okay, so this is the way how, by consuming 70 grams of protein by a 70 kg male, the protein content of the body can be maintained. Let's say if proteins are not taken at all, then what will happen? Per day, 70 grams of protein equivalent of urea is eliminated. So gradually your body will lack protein content. Amino acid nitrogen levels will go down. So that will affect severely your functionality as well as cell communication systems. Okay, friends, this is the way how protein digestion and absorption and further distribution into various ways is happening in our body. Okay, so a healthy male has to consume per day approximately 1 gram per kg of the body weight of proteins for maintenance of body protein levels. Okay, so I hope you got the point. So we'll continue this discussion in the next class, where we'll we have a detailed discussion on amino acid metabolism. Okay. Thank you all for your time and patient listening. If you have any doubts, please let me know through the comment section. Please share this video with your friends so that they will also get benefited out of it. See you all with another very interesting lecture soon. Thank you.